Today we're going back to the Supreme Court, and boy, I haven't been here in a while. Feels good, like an old sweater. It's definitely been a slower term as far as interesting Supreme Court rulings, unless you're really into private cemetery rights, or learning whether a mobile home in a trailer park is considered a building for the purposes of a robbery charge. Yeah, that was a redneck court case. Turns out, burglary extends to breaking into a mobile home or a tent. The more you know. Today, that all changes in a case I've been watching like some people watch reality TV. And that case would be Nielsen v. Preap, a case that just broadened the president's power to detain immigrants without bail hearing. One important thing to note is we're not talking about undocumented immigrants here, but instead, permanent residents and people with visas. So things are even less black and white. First, a little backstory. This case revolves around a few non-citizen legal residents who committed crimes in America. They served their time and then were released. No scandal yet. Then years later, or in the case of one of those legal residents who was caught in possession of a stolen bus transfer 11 years later, ICE came and took them into custody and detained them without bond hearings. Now you might be asking yourself, what crime do you have to commit for that treatment? And I'll jump ahead a little bit and just read directly from Justice Breyer's decision. They may have been convicted for only minor crimes, for example, minor drug offenses or crimes of moral turpitude, such as illegally downloading music or possession of stolen bus transfers. Now, I've never pirated music, or at least I'm not dumb enough to admit it on camera, especially on a show analyzing the courts, but oh man, if you want to start detaining people for pirating, you better be ready to lock up half the country. The question the Supreme Court was trying to answer was, can you detain someone years or decades after they're released from jail without a bail hearing? Or do you have to pick them up right out of the gates? With that, let's get right into it.
We'll hear argument first this morning in case 16-1363, Nielsen, Secretary of Homeland Security versus Preap.
Before we get too into the weeds, there are two more layers of nuance that you need to understand. Specifically, first, why is the Department of Homeland Security bringing these people in? And second, what is the significance of a bond hearing? This might surprise some of you never-Trumpers, but the DHS isn't rounding up these documented immigrants who broke the law because arresting minorities is fun. They're bringing them in to begin removal proceedings. And this is where bail hearings are so desired. If you're an immigrant who got caught, say, pirating movies and was released from jail 10 years ago, you might be able to post bail and wait for your court date and removal in your community or with your family. If you're not given a bail hearing, you're legally guaranteed to have to wait months or years in a detention center until your case gets heard. This point is important to keep in the back of your head because it came up a lot in this case. In reality though, the whole debate revolves around a very specific subsection of a subsection in the Immigration and Naturalization Act. Specifically, section 1226C1. Wow, that is specific. That requires immigration authorities to detain non-citizens who have committed certain crimes when they're released from criminal custody. The question is, what does when they're released mean? Does it mean when they're released? Or any time, even decades after they're released? As you can imagine, parts of this argument got super grammar heavy and what the meaning of the word is, including a heated debate between Neil Gorsuch and the immigration lawyer over the circumstances in which an adverb can modify a noun. It was truly riveting stuff. Fortunately for you guys, the main arguments couldn't double as SAT questions. And that's what I'm going to focus on today. So what's the question we're trying to answer?
We have to decide whether when the alien is released means, as you say, as the Ninth Circuit said, immediately, within 48 hours, within some reasonable period, or after the alien is released. In simple terms, that's the question before us, right?
Hey, thanks for teeing that one up for me. Now keep that question in your mind, because the more I talk about this case, the more our goal of answering that very specific question will get diluted. The case isn't whether it's constitutional to bring someone straight from jail to an ICE detention center without a hearing. While that is unarguably a dick move on its own, hey, you're free. Now come with me to the detention center. It's been decided. Last term, the court ruled in Jennings v. Rodriguez that picking up an immigrant without a bail hearing for specific crimes is A-OK under this upon-release statute. Specifically, the court decided that the same statute did mandate bondless detention for at least some criminal aliens. Which, wow, expect an episode on that when the news slows down in maybe 4 years. Now, the question here is, 50 years down the road, can you detain a permanent resident or a person staying on a visa for a past possession of a stolen bus transfer without a bond hearing?
I take it you don't think the government could come back 50 years later and arrest somebody who's a grandfather or something, you know, he stole some bus transfers 50 years earlier. Is that what you think C authorizes?
That was Justice Breyer, and it was clear that he was not having it with this administration's logic. When the lawyer responded to this question, he almost sounded scared.
So, first, of course, our top-line answer is that this statute is not ambiguous, that the only plausible reading
of
this
in light— So you think a person 50 years later, who is on his deathbed, after stealing some bus transfers— This paragraph says that the Attorney General shall release him and hold him without bail, even though in this country, a triple axe murderer is given bail.
This is where things start to get confusing, because justices keep going back to the question of whether an immigrant can be detained without a bond hearing. Especially Breyer. He really thought he had struck gold with that axe murderer bit, bringing up how even they get a bond hearing quite a few times. And if you listen to this case, it's clear that Breyer really has an axe to grind with that very specific class of murderers. I mean, I'm sorry, but it's time to bury the hatchet on that grudge. Now, you might be scratching your head and thinking, wait, he said that this disagreement was settled by the Supreme Court last year. Well, the idea of picking someone up without a bond hearing only applies to a person who is taken in upon release. This is why it's so important to find out exactly when an immigrant goes from the status of being released, where they can't have a bond hearing, to the status of, yeah, that guy was released and it's no longer being released, which would make him qualify for a bond hearing. Still, you had that looming question of whether you can detain someone 50 years down the line for being in possession of a stolen bus transfer all those years ago without any sort of hearing. Until...
sentence requirement under the statute.
Is the government's position that this paragraph, which says she'll be arrested upon release, applies to a person who has been released 50 years before? What is your position? I'm not even criticizing it.
Our position is absolutely that this applies regardless of the time in.
Okay.
Jeez. Okay, so that's a yes. That could be a flaw in the administration's argument, but it's a moral argument rather than a legal one. And citing morality on the Supreme Court is like citing the Bible in your paper on evolution. It's not going to help unless you can bring it back to the law. So what is the legal argument against this? Well, it largely relies on congressional intent. Basically, in the context of 1995, when Congress wrote down when they were released, what did they mean? Now we could probably ask them, because many of them are still alive, but that wouldn't be as much fun. Well, let's speculate.
The first anomaly is, as you noted, that the transition rules, which were meant to be a ramp up to the permanent rule, are completely superfluous. If the government really could delay, for whatever reason, picking up people subject to mandatory detention for as long as it needs or wants, then Congress would not need to have that intermediate step.
Bear with me, because, oh man, this is one of those explanations where it takes a few sentences to start making sense. The way this act was written, there was a detention transition period. Because if you immediately start detaining every legal immigrant who commits a crime, well, ICE is going to be running out of beds pretty quickly. The argument is that, when Congress passed this act, they put in a transition period because their intent was to be picking up every non-citizen upon their release from jail. If they could just sit back and wait a few years until the vacancy lights turned on at the local detention center, there would be no need for a transition period. In other words, if I were to tell my roommates that, from now on, we're going to be housing everybody who subscribes to this YouTube channel, as soon as they subscribe, my roommates would probably say, "Hold on a second, we have to get ready for that. That's about to be a lot of people. Wink, wink." It's okay. I'll wait. Oh, on the other hand, if I said, "Yeah, I'm going to start bringing in a few subscribers when we have a free couch for them to crash on," well, we wouldn't need that transition period. Let's take a second to unpack that, because some of you might be coming to the realization that, wait, are the more liberal justices arguing that we should be detaining legal immigrants who commit crimes right after they do their time, while the more conservative judges are saying that they can be released into the community, live for years, only to be snatched up a decade or so after their release? And yeah, from a certain perspective...
Immediately, so as soon as the person is walks out of the door of the prison or the jail, if ICE doesn't take the person into custody at that point, that's the end of it?
And no, Your Honor. We would ask the court to affirm the Ninth Circuit, which said that a reasonable degree of immediacy is appropriate.
A reasonable degree of immediacy. Basically, you can't leave someone waiting in a detention limbo 50-plus years, just waiting for the ICE van to pull up and take him away. And this triggered another long and semantic debate, coming to a pinnacle when John Roberts said,
"I mean, there's a difference between reasonable degree of immediacy and reasonable time. I don't see how immediate is immediate."
When I heard that, a little bit of my brain said, "Well, it's been fun, but I'll see you tomorrow." His point is the same criticism Democrats levy at the emergency declaration. You can't use the circuit court's measure of a term of reasonable degree of immediacy because if it's a requisite to be immediate, you can't be reasonable. Now, this kept going for some time, with the progressive lawyer eventually saying it should be a day after the release. But it doesn't really matter that much because that side had lost the argument. The last important thing to know about this argument is that, let's say you want to detain a legal immigrant who committed one of those crimes I mentioned earlier. Can you suddenly just never pick them up because, well, I didn't save the date on their release? No.
And if the government, for whatever reason, doesn't take custody when the alien is released, we think same day is fine, then the person gets a hearing under subsection A, and that's the only consequence, as Justice Breyer noted.
Yeah, so the big difference is you can get an opportunity to have a bail hearing if you're detained after a certain deadline. Not exactly the most progressive options out there, but hey, we're interpreting statutes from the 90s, so what did you expect? So what did the other side say? Well,
I don't think that's right, because it says when, that might be right if it said something like, the secretary shall take into custody any alien who is inadmissible and deportable, you know, and who has not been released for more than such and such amount of time. But that's not what it says. It says when the alien is released, which I think takes as a given that he's already been fully described.
Yeah, it's like when my friend tells me to pick him up from the airport, and I show up 11 years later. You really should have specified the time you wanted me to pick you up. Within the hour of your flight landing? Okay. Because Congress never specified any statute of limitations on the detention pickup process, you can, in this case, successfully make that argument. Furthermore, as Justice Kavanaugh pointed out,
the problem is that Congress did not trust those hearings. Is my understanding, and correct me if I'm wrong about that, but Congress was concerned that those hearings were not working in the way that Congress wanted, and therefore for a certain class of criminal or terrorist aliens said no more.
Earlier in this statute, Congress had specifically said that documented immigrants who commit these crimes should not be given the opportunity to post bail. So why, if you pick them up years down the line, would you suddenly give them the opportunity to post bail? Interestingly enough, this sentiment was actually echoed by Ruth Bader Ginsburg.
Suppose I'm the alien in the category that's picked up immediately, and I ask you to explain to me why I don't get a hearing, and yet someone who had the benefit of being out for 2 years, 3 years, does get a hearing.
Yeah. That really does seem a little odd. The result of this argument? A 5-4 split amongst conservative-progressive lines. in the decision that, without a bail hearing, immigrants will be held in detention centers for months or years that it's going to take to process their potential deportation claims. Now, I recently did an episode about how our detention centers are overflowing right now because we're detaining an all-time high number of immigrants. And we'll just put it this way, I think that coverage is about to get a lot more politically relevant with this latest decision. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello YouTube, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, I have two interesting videos to recommend you guys. This top one is my coverage of the case of Zydvydas v. Davis, a Supreme Court case that determined both legal and illegal immigrants are constitutionally protected if they're on US sovereign soil. Well, just spoiled that one. And down here we have the coverage I mentioned there at the end about how our detention centers are overflowing. Other than that, if you want to support independent, nonpartisan news looking into the Supreme Court, you can click on this floating logo to the right of my head. Give me a thumbs up if you like what you saw. And lastly, as always, thank you for watching.